This conference will now be recorded.
Today's class is about pulmonary thromboembolism. First, we have to know about the pulmonary circulation. The pulmonary trunk, it takes origin from the right ventricle. And in adults, the main pulmonary artery measures approximately 5 centimeters in length and is entirely enveloped within the pericardium. And at about the level of fifth thoracic vertebra, it divides into longer right and shorter left pulmonary artery. According to the literature, in adults, the upper limit of normal for pulmonary trunk is 29 to 33 mm, and 23 mm for right pulmonary artery and 22 mm for left pulmonary artery. Coming to pulmonary thromboembolism, pulmonary embolism refers to embolic occlusion of the pulmonary arterial system. The majority of the cases result from thrombotic occlusion, and therefore the condition is frequently termed as pulmonary thromboembolism. Over 90% of the pulmonary emboli originate from the thrombus in the deep veins of the legs and pelvis. Rarely it originates in the renal or upper extremity veins or the right heart chambers. Now we have to discuss about the pathophysiology. Thrombus in deep veins of the lower limb, they break off leading to the emboli formation, and now they start moving to the right heart. From the right heart, they move to the pulmonary circulation and they launch in the pulmonary vascular bed. Usually the thrombus are more common in the deep veins, and from deep veins they dislodge and they get into the right heart, and from right heart the emboli they come to the pulmonary circulation. Large thrombi seen at the bifurcation in the pulmonary artery called as saddle embolus, and they lead to hemodynamic compromise. And smaller emboli, they occlude the smaller vessels in the lung periphery, more likely to produce pleuritic chest pain by initiating an inflammatory response adjacent to the parietal pleura. Most pulmonary emboli are multiple, and the lower lobes are more commonly involved than the upper lobes. Most patients with pulmonary thromboembolism have no obvious symptoms at the time of presentation. The most common symptoms of pulmonary thromboembolism in the prospective investigation of pulmonary thromboembolism diagnosis include dyspnea, pleuritic chest pain, cough, and hemoptysis. Most of the patients will have dyspnea. The classic clinical trend of sudden chest pain, dyspnea, and hemoptysis is present in only minority of the cases. Other symptoms and signs may be cough, syncope, tachycardia, fever, signs of deep vein thrombosis. Coming to the causes of pulmonary embolism, the risk factors for the development of pulmonary embolism are related to vitrostride. You all know that vitrostride contains endothelial injury, and there will be some venous stasis, and there should be some blood hypercoagulability. So the conditions like venous stasis, hypercoagulable states, immobilization, surgery and trauma, pregnancy, OC pills usage and estrogen replacement therapy, and malignant conditions and others like a stroke and indwelling venous catheters, and previous history of any venous thromboembolism, and previous history of congestive heart failure, and fractures of the long bones like femur, and obesity, varicose veins, and inflammatory bowel diseases. These all are the predisposing factors for pulmonary embolism. Now coming to the clinical prediction, Wells criteria, Geneva score, and pulmonary embolism rule out criteria, these are the clinical predictions. Wells criteria, if there is a previous pulmonary embolism or DVT, it will be given 1 point. If the heart rate is more than 100 beats per minute, again 1 point. And surgery or immobilization less than 4 weeks duration, it is again given 1 point. And history of hemoptysis, active cancer, other clinical signs of DVT, and alternative diagnosis if it is less likely, they all are given 1 points. And clinical probability of pulmonary embolism, if it is unlikely, it is given less than 1 point. And if the clinical probability of pulmonary embolism is more than one, is likely, it is given more than 1 point. Coming to the investigations, D-dimer assay, plain radiograph, CT, ventilation perfusion scan, MRI, and ultrasound are the investigations. Coming to the D-dimer. D-dimer is formed when cross-linked fibrin is lysed by the plasmin and elevated levels usually occur with pulmonary embolism. However, because elevations of D-dimer are non-specific and they are increased by the aging, inflammation, cancer, an abnormal result has a low positive predictive value. So we should not depend only on the D-dimer levels because they are also raised in other conditions like old age and any other inflammation and any other malignant conditions. The value of D-dimer is that negative result can help to exclude pulmonary embolism. So it only has negative predictive value. That means if the D-dimer is negative, the chances of pulmonary embolism are less. But if it is positive, it is not only due to pulmonary thromboembolism. There are so many other causes. Coming to plain chest radiography, the chest X-ray may be normal in up to 40% of the patients with pulmonary embolism, or it may show some non-specific findings even in extensive pulmonary embolism. The chest X-ray is performed not to diagnose pulmonary embolism, but to exclude other causes of symptoms of chest pain, such as pneumonia, pleuritis, or pneumothorax. Although they are infrequently present, at non-specific, there are several signs related to pulmonary embolism, and therefore suggestive, but still they do not confirm the diagnosis of pulmonary embolism. The most important chest radiograph findings are Hampton's hump. This is a pleural-based wedge-shaped opacity with its apex of the triangle pointing towards the occluding vessel or hilum. It is typically not seen in the first 24 hours after embolus has lodged in the pulmonary artery, and it just represents the parenchymal infarction. This condition may take 3 to 5 weeks up to months to resolve, and a band-like opacity due to scarring or focal pleural thickening may remain. The opacity may not always be triangular as the infarction may be surrounded by hemorrhage. If the infarcted area becomes secondary infected, cavitation or abscess formation may occur. These opacities may not only be seen in case of infarction but also result of edema and hemorrhage. The latter are usually found in lower lobes from 12 hours. Here we have to remember that in Hampton hump there is a pleural based wedge shaped opacity with its triangle pointing towards occluding vessel. Here we can see the pleural based, this is the pleural based radio opacity noted with its apex pointing towards the occluded vessel. Here this is the CT images showing the wedge shaped pleural opacities. These opacities are pointing towards the occluded vessel. This is the pulmonary infarctions we can see here. These are the Hampton humps in the radiograph. And after recovery, the patient has some fibrotic scars. Pleischner sign. Pleischner sign refers to the prominent central pulmonary artery that can be commonly caused either by the distension of vessel by the large pulmonary embolus or pulmonary hypertension. Here we can see that this is the pulmonary hilum, And these are the pulmonary arteries and the pulmonary veins arising from the hilum. And here we can see there is dilated central pulmonary artery. It is because of the distension by the embolus. Western Mott's sign. It is defined by a hyperlucent cheia with decreased vascularity due to oligemia of the involved part of the lung. Although this finding is not specific, it should be considered. Here we can see the relative hyperlucent lung compared to the other side. And here we can see that there are decreased lung mass comparatively. Nakulat's sausage sign. Describing dilatation of the central pulmonary artery due to occlusion by the embolus with collapse or constriction of the distal arteries, resulting in an abrupt tapering of the arteries. Here we can see there is dilatation of the central pulmonary artery. Here it is occluded by the embolus, and there is a collapse or constriction. There is sudden tapering of the distal arteries. This is the knuckle or sausage sign. And last sign. It is enlarged right descending pulmonary artery. This is the enlarged right descending pulmonary artery, and it is the fungus sign. Chest X-ray findings in brief. Fleischner sign. It means enlarged pulmonary artery. Hampton's hump. We all know that it is the peripheral wedge-shaped airspace opacity, and it implies that there is lung infarction. And Western Mott sign. There is regional oligemia, and we can see it as hyperlucent lung. Pleural effusion. Knuckle sign. Abrupt tapering or cutoff of the pulmonary artery secondary to embolus. Pallas sign. Enlarged right descending pulmonary artery. Chang sign. Dilated right descending pulmonary artery with sudden cutoff. And there are peripheral aid space opacities, diaphragmatic elevation, and linear atelectasis. Ventilation perfusion lung scanning. Previously, the imaging of choice for pulmonary embolism is ventilation perfusion scan, but now it is largely replaced by the CT. Nuclear medicine studies, it is a nuclear medicine study, and it is sensitive for pulmonary embolism. It is lower cost and low radiation, and a normal perfusion scan excludes pulmonary embolism, but is mainly found in the minority of the patients. Ventilation scan. Ventilation is achieved by technetium 99m labeled microsol agents, which are nothing but aerosolized technetium 99m diethylene trivalent pentaacetic acid, which are inhaled via the nebulizer and deposited on the bronchoalveolar lining, demonstrating the areas of ventilated lung. And the perfusion scan is performed with the technetium 99m labeled albumin. Then images are then obtained in 8 projections like anterior, posterior, posterior, anterior, right and left lateral, right and left anterior, and posterior oblique views. A normal perfusion study rules out pulmonary embolism with almost 100% certainty, and further investigations is not indicated. If the perfusion defect is present, further imaging is warranted. These are the normal perfusion images, and these are the normal ventilation images. Coming to CT pulmonary angiography. If the patient has any signs and symptoms of pulmonary embolism, we have to directly advise the patient CT pulmonary angiography, because ventilation perfusion and chest X-rays are not that reliable. The gold standard test for investigation of pulmonary thromboembolism is CT pulmonary angiography. It is more accurate than scintigraphy, and it is rapid, non-invasive, and readily available. In CT pulmonary artery findings in acute pulmonary embolism, due to arterial occlusion with failure to enhance the entire lumen, due to large filling defect, the artery may be enlarged compared with the adjacent patent vessels. A partial filling defect surrounded by the contrast material producing polomin sign-on images acquired perpendicular to the long axis of the vessel, and the railway track sign-on longitudinal images of the vessel. A peripheral intraluminal defect that forms acute angles with the arterial wall. Here we can see the polomin sign. Here, after giving the contrast, the central part of the artery is not showing any contrast enhancement because this is the embolus, and the rest of the lumen, which is patent, is showing contrast enhancement. The central dark area with surrounding bright area, this appears like a polomy, and it is one of the sign of CT signs of pulmonary thromboembolism. Here we can see these all the vessels, these are appearing bright, but this vessel is appearing dark. That means it is occluded by the pulmonary embolism. Here we can see the filling defect. Here also we can see that this vessel is filling completely, but here this vessel is filling only peripherally. So that we can say that here there is some filling defect. Here we can see clearly that this is the normal vessel which is filling completely. So it is bright, but here we can see that in this vessel, the central area is dark. That means there is some embolus. This is the CT sign of pulmonary embolism. Here also you can see that this is the CT image showing this is the pulmonary artery. This is the ascending aorta, this is the descending aorta. And here the pulmonary artery bifurcating into right and left. Here we can see that there is some central dark area. This is the embolus part. Chronic pulmonary embolism, a complete obstruction by the thrombus of a pulmonary artery that shows decrease in diameter as compared to surrounding non-obstructed pulmonary arteries. It's an eccentric partial intralumenar filling defect with obtuse angle to the vessel. We have discussed that in acute pulmonary embolism, there will be dilatation of the vessel and the thrombus forms acute angles with the vessel wall. But here in chronic embolism, there will be the decrease in diameter of the vessel and the thrombus forms an obtuse angle to the vessel wall. Here we can see the chronic embolic. Here. Summary. Acute pulmonary embolism is the third most common acute cardiovascular disease and consequently the major cause of mortality and morbidity and hospitalization. Clinical signs and symptoms of both acute and chronic pulmonary embolism are non-specific. In acute pulmonary embolism, clinical prediction rules help to categorize the patients into low, moderate, and high probability risk groups. And pulmonary embolism can be safely excluded when there is a low or moderate pretest probability in combination with a negative D-dimer test. Multi-detector computed tomography pulmonary angiography is a first imaging test of choice for acute pulmonary embolism. If positive for pulmonary embolism, right ventricular dilatation should be assessed as this is an independent predictor for adverse clinical outcome. Okay, now the class is completed.
Gracias.